वेलकम टू रेड क्लिम. दिस इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट लेक्चर आई वुड से दैट वी हैव स्टार्टेड इन दिस पर्टिकुलर सीरीज ऑफ क्लिनिकल रेडियोलॉजी. एंड वाई इट इज इम्पॉर्टेंट, इट्स इम्पॉर्टेंट बिकॉज दीज आर द बेसिक्स दैट वी आर गोना डिस्कस नाउ. ओके, एंड बेसिक्स आर ऑलवेज इम्पॉर्टेंट बिकॉज दे फॉर्म द फाउंडेशन ऑफ एनी थिंग दैट इज कॉम्प्लेक्स. एंड इफ यू आर नॉट अवेयर ऑफ द बेसिक्स और नॉट थरो विद द बेसिक्स, नो मैटर हाउ मच यू ट्राई, you won't be able to get the hold of the thing. Okay, so why it is important also, because when we discuss chest radiology, okay, this is a sequence, you know, let's say what a radiologist does basically. So we receive investigation, let's say we receive an HRCT, okay, we have an HRCT image on with us, and when we see an HRCT image, what we do is basically we describe findings first. This is the first step we do. Description of findings. Okay. So description of findings is the first step. What we see, we describe. Okay. So that is where the radiology part is there. Okay. That is where the radiology is there. Radiology per se. This is 100% pure radiology. Okay. No role of clinical science in that. Now, when you describe the findings, okay, then the next step for you, the objective that you aim for is to make a diagnosis. Now, to make a diagnosis, remember this thing. Yeah, definitely there are findings, yeah, they are very telltale or they are very characteristic of a particular disease, but mostly things are not like this. And what we need, we very frequently need role of clinical science. And the contribution is especially history, which commonly first year radiology residents are asked to do so. History, clinical history. Another important point would be sometimes or pulmonary function test findings. Okay. Lab findings, whether they are CBC findings, TLC count, okay, sometimes bronchoalveolar lavage findings, okay, sometimes when you, let's say, your viral markers, okay, and so many things, okay, which could be important. History of exposure, there are so many things, okay. Investigations, lab findings, PFT finding, history, sometimes physical examination findings, clinicians. So why these are important? Why these are important? The reason being very clear that when you describe the findings, you commonly fit these findings into a pattern. You commonly fit this into a pattern. And this pattern in itself is useless unless and until it is combined with the knowledge of the clinical science. Okay. And that is where, unless and until you combine this with the knowledge of the clinical science and these lab findings, you won't be able to make a diagnosis. Ultimately, you make a diagnosis only on the basis of clinical science that is combined with radiology. That is why the videos are named as clinical radiology. Okay. So that is a basic concept. Okay. That how we step. How we step up from one step to another when we want to describe findings, then we make a diagnosis. Okay, so right now in this particular video, why it is important to tell this particular thing is because what we are going to discuss is we are going to discuss this step number one. Okay, in last few videos, like for example sarcoidosis or hypersensitivity pneumonitis, we discussed basically the disease per se. Okay, we discussed about a disease, how sarcoidosis is gonna present radiologically. Okay, and what are the patterns? Okay, we discussed that. But central to every disease, okay, unless you know this thing that what all few findings are there, or what are the, you know, the findings that you commonly see on HRCT, you won't be able to make a pattern. Because you make a pattern only when you describe findings. So the first step goes with a description of the findings. And that is where this lecture comes into play. that a description of findings becomes important, and that is why this lecture has to be, you know, it's these are basically nothing but the basics. Okay, what you see, you need to describe it. Okay, so let's simply jump into this lecture. And the first thing, first and foremost thing, before we start to tabulate the findings, we commonly see common opacities, patterns on HRCT. But most important thing is to understand the anatomy. Okay, to understand the anatomy. And for the anatomy, I have one diagram with it. Okay, just look at it. So see this. Okay, very simple diagram. These are two lungs and trachea dividing into bronchi and this. So, but more importantly, what we need to see is that here also vessels are there. Okay, so we have vessels also. We must be having vessels. Vessels. Okay. Now, in lungs or in lung parenchyma, if I talk about the lung parenchyma, what do we have? We have air space. Okay, that is one thing. I'm talking about lung parenchyma. Lung parenchyma. We have air space. And second thing that we have is interstitium. Okay. Why do you see lungs black? Okay. Only because of the air. So you see very, you know, quite a lot air in the lungs. But there are also other things that we see on HRCT. We see vessels, we see bronchioles, we see bronchi. Okay, and we also see interstitium if it's thicker. Okay, so that airspace and interstitium, okay, they form the lung parenchyma. Now, we know what, you know, airspace is, we know what is alveoli, we know where alveolar ducts are. Okay, but just a brief understanding of this. So, this bronchi is going to divide. Okay, and we know that there are commonly three lobes. On right, two lobes on left. So bronchi is going to divide. Bronchi is going to divide into your lobar bronchi first. Okay, so three lobar bronchi, two lobar bronchi on the left, three on the right. Then these lobar bronchi, each lobe is going to have going to be having segments. And in combined, if we combine all, then both lungs have 10 segments, bronchopulmonary segments. So we are going to have segmental bronchi as well. And these are also going to divide. So ultimately, there'll come a point when they're going to divide from center to periphery. Okay, there'll come a point where they reaches a particular division where that particular bronchiole. Now, what is the difference between bronchi and bronchiole? That is also important. Radiologically, bronchi and bronchiole are simply differentiated by the finding of cartilage. You have cartilage in bronchi. You do not have cartilage in bronchiole. It's fall. Okay, anyway, so we reach a point where, you know, we call that particular bronchiole as terminal bronchiole. And there's a reason why we call it terminal bronchiole. Why? Because it is the last bronchiole. Okay, it is the last bronchiole that is going to be without air space associated with it. Okay, it will be the last. After that terminal bronchiole, the next division will create bronchioles known as respiratory bronchiole. Okay, respiratory bronchiole. And these respiratory bronchiole are known as respiratory bronchiole because they have associated air spaces associated with them. Okay. And it commonly occurs after 23 divisions, if I'm not wrong. Okay, so air spaces are associated, and distal to this respiratory bronchiole, we're going to have air spaces. So the exchange of gas or the function of lungs, it happens distal, basically respiratory bronchiole onwards. Until terminal bronchiole, the primary function of these airways are simply to conduct the air. So they are conducting airways. Okay, so after this, now look at this image. Okay, so here you can clearly see very beautifully they have explained it. You know, they have divided it. So this is your terminal bronchiole at this particular level. Okay, then we are moving, okay, ultimately we reach at this particular point. Okay, see this. This is an alveolus. Okay, these spaces, these are alveolus, these round round spaces, and these are associated with this is, and this is your bronchiole. Okay, this is your bronchiole. This is your bronchiole. The air spaces are associated with bronchioles. Okay, so that's why this bronchiole is a respiratory bronchiole. Okay, ultimately it divides. Okay, then it divides. Ultimately, it forms what, alveolar ducts. Then it forms alveolar sacs and finally alveoli. Okay, these are the divisions. So distal to respiratory bronchiole, you have, or respiratory bronchiole onwards, you have air spaces which forms the functional part of the lung. Now, important point that we need to know is that if I take one respiratory bronchiole, okay, if I take one respiratory bronchiole, okay, and let's say this is your respiratory bronchiole, and ultimately it's going to divide, okay, no, distally, whatever it's going to happen. So this particular unit, okay, with one respiratory bronchiole and its divisions is known as a sinus. And to be clear, a sinus is nothing but the functional and the structural unit of lung. Okay, a sinus is a structural and functional unit of lung. Okay, and what it does basically, this, let's say this is your respiratory bronchiole, this is the respiratory bronchiole. Okay, this is your respiratory bronchiole, let's say this. Okay, so this is respiratory bronchiole, because here where the spaces are there, this is another respiratory bronchiole, this is one respiratory bronchiole, this must be your terminal bronchiole. Exactly, this is your terminal bronchiole. Now it is respiratory bronchiole, various spaces are there. So one respiratory bronchiole, and distal to it everything like this. Okay, everything, this is what is your sinus. This is your sinus. Okay, let me take the red color. So this is your sinus, everything that I have shaded, distal to respiratory bronchiole. Similarly, this respiratory bronchiole also have the same thing. Okay, and a sinus is what is the structural and functional unit of lung parenchyma. Okay, structural and functional unit of lung parenchyma. Okay, clearly. Now, next important thing. Now, next important thing is this, that if you see closely, now what is another term that you must have heard somewhere, okay, is gonna be your this, and that is a term that, you know, radiologically it is very important, very very important to, you know, because it forms the foundation of the description of the findings on HRCT. So what is that finding? That particular term is secondary pulmonary nodule. Okay, secondary pulmonary nodule, sorry, not nodule, definitely not nodule, but lobule. Is lobule. Okay, secondary pulmonary lobule. Now, importantly, why it is important to understand secondary pulmonary lobule? Okay, why it is important? So, okay, you know, for that particular thing, we need to understand this diagram. See this diagram. Okay. So this is nothing but your secondary pulmonary nodule, lobule, secondary pulmonary lobule, and you can clearly see it is almost hexagonal shape, and what I have shown is this is nothing but your peripheral part of the lung. It's a periphery. So this is your pleura. Okay, this is your pleura. Okay, and this is a zoomed image of a secondary pulmonary lobule. Okay, so okay, now important thing is that, you know, when we discuss about the functional unit of the lung, we call it to be a sinus, or the structural unit, we call it to be a sinus. Why it is important? Because it is the smallest part that takes part in respiration. Okay, but these everything that we discuss, from bronchi, main bronchi, to ultimately sinus, main bronchi to alveoli, is arranged in the form of a pattern. Okay, it's structurally arranged in the form of certain units, and those units are known as your secondary pulmonary lobule. So basically, if we go anatomy wise, the lung parenchyma is basically arranged in the form of hexagonal structures. Okay, hexagonal structures like this. Like this. Okay, they're going to arrange like this. And when they reach the periphery, like this is your pleural surface, so definitely it will appear like this. Okay, it will appear like this. Like this, or what is shown here. See this. This is the pleural surface. In the center, they appear like these hexagonal structures. Okay. And these are nothing but your secondary pulmonary lobules. Okay. Now we need to discuss about the structure of this particular, this particular structure that we need to understand. And very, very important, because that's going to be forming the foundation of the findings that we're going to see. So if you see this structure very clearly, let me myself make it. Okay, so we're going to take this. Okay, let's draw the pleural surface. Let's say this is your pleural surface. Okay, and these at the periphery I'm drawing. So these are two secondary pulmonary module. Okay, and so these black lines, okay, that I have just drawn, this is a pleura, visceral pleura to be precise. And what are these? These are nothing but, these lines are nothing but your interlobular septa. Interlobular, because they are dividing two lobules, these are interlobular septa. Okay, interlobular septa. Now let's draw the structures that enter it. Okay, so we are going to draw the vessels and the bronchioles. So we're going to draw the vessels with the obviously red. So this is your vessel or branch of pulmonary artery that is dividing. Okay, so this is pulmonary artery that is dividing, and it is entering into two lobules. Okay, similarly we'll be having bronchiole. So we show bronchiole to this. Okay, and bronchiole goes with branch of pulmonary artery only. And if you clearly see, they ultimately reach the center of the sinus, not a sinus, they reach the center of PL or secondary pulmonary lobule. Okay, so they are reaching the center. Okay, okay. Another thing that is left is, what is there in the septa? What is there in the septa? Septa also contains something. So septa contains what? It contains veins. That is what is left. Veins are left. Okay. Veins are there in the septa. I need to draw veins here. Okay. Veins are there. Veins are going to be there in the septa. And with veins, we are also going to have lymphatics. Okay. We are going to have lymphatics. and let's show lymphatic with green. Okay, we have lymphatics also here. Okay, so we have lymphatics. So we have made, I think, everything that we needed. Okay, now use the black color to tell what exactly they are. So this is nothing but your artery. This is your bronchiole. These are your vein. And ultimately, this is your lymphatics. Okay, now if you see closely, this is the center part of the nodule, lobule. This is the center. This is the center. Okay, and one thing is very important that I missed. Okay, that if you that is very specific for the subpleural area. Subpleural area is this. This is your subpleural area. What is there? Here also you see lymphatics. Here also lymphatics are there in the subpleural area. Okay, remember this thing. Immediate to pleura is lymphatics. Each and everything that I am going to tell now, or I am telling now, okay, or I am describing, has an importance because it will form the concept. Okay, so this is the basic structure of secondary pulmonary lobule. Okay, now we are this in the center part. We have this ultimately. So what and what is there? What is in the white? The white portion that is left. That portion. What is this white portion? So this white portion that you are seeing here, this white portion that I've just, you know, shaded this portion, whatever is left portion, what is this portion? So this portion is nothing but your air. Here you have air. Okay, here you have air. Basically, you have alveoli, alveolar ducts, alveolar sacs, or simply air containing structure. So basically, and this is where, you know, so these vessels, this particular bronchiole that you're gonna see, it must be terminal bronchiole, and when it enters it, now it starts dividing into, you know, after reaching this point or the center, it starts dividing into respiratory bronchiole and ultimately respiratory, because at this point, up till this point, you do not have air spaces. From the center to periphery of this lobule, it starts dividing to respiratory bronchiole and then ultimately finally to the periphery of the lobule leading to alveoli. So you have, you know, divisions going on from center of the lobule to periphery also. Okay, and these are the divisions that ultimately finally leads to, you know, from center to periphery forming the alveoli. So you see alveoli here on the periphery. Okay, and that is why air is there in this region, because all those respiratory bronchial onwards contains air. Okay, so that is about the structure, and that is how our lung is simply made of. Okay, then now once we understand this concept, you know, this will help us understand the findings, radiological findings on X-ray as well as on CT scan. But we'll go by HRCT first. Okay. And whatever we're going to see on HRCT, we're going to correlate it with X-ray findings as well. Okay. So just move on. Okay. So let's start another section. And here we are. So the first important thing, okay, that we need to understand is, and we have discussed it also, that we saw this particular diagram, okay, and whenever we will keep on going to this diagram, okay, as per our convenience. So the first finding that is important on HRCT that you will see is, you know, let me label it, okay, that is to be your, you know, reticular opacities. Reticular opacities. Okay, or let me just tabulate what all findings we have. We have reticular pastries, that is one thing. Okay, then another thing that we could have, or we can have, is simply what we can have nodules. Third thing that we can have is increase in density of lung. Or opacity, increased density of lung. Fourth thing that I can have is decrease in density of lung. So whatever findings we have on HRCT, I can describe or classify them under these four categories. And these are nothing but, this classification is nothing but encompassing all the findings or radiology findings of HRCT. HRCT chest. Okay, they could be reticular opacity, they could be nodules, they could be increased density of lung or decreased density of lung, and obviously these are further classified further. Okay, but you know, these are the findings. So first and foremost, what we're going to do is reticular opacities. Okay, what is reticular opacities? What all comes in reticular opacities? Okay, yeah. So see, in reticular opacity, okay, the first important thing that comes under it is interlobular septal thickening. And I have just told what exactly is interlobular septa. Interlobular septal thickening is the important thing that comes under this. Okay, so we know what is interlobular septa. We have just, you know, this was your, let's say, whatever was your secondary pulmonary lobule. These were your interlobular septa, and when they get thickened, that is what is called interlobular septal thickening. Now the important question is that I should have told it that time also, that what is seen on HRCT, what all parts of secondary pulmonary lobule are seen on HRCT. Okay, because the HRCT also has a limitation of resolution. Okay, it cannot show everything. So what is that? So see in this diagram, you know, what all you can see. So most important thing is that you cannot see interlobular septa. I'm just simply cutting it. Okay, you cannot see interlobular septa on HRCT. Remember this thing. The resolution is not like this. Only and only in very, you know, only in the cases, only thin sections where you have, you know, at the periphery, you might see these septas. Okay, in normal image as well, these septa, especially those, you know, that are perpendicular to the pleura. You might see, but although you don't see them, interlobular septa is not visible. Okay, because they are very thin. The size is almost 0.1 mm. Okay, thickness 0.1 mm. Similarly, if you talk about lymphatics, you do not see. Okay, are you able to see bronchioles? Yes, we can see bronchioles. Okay, bronchioles are visible. But remember this thing: bronchioles are visible only up till you know. Let's say if this is your lung. If this is your lung and you see, obviously you follow the bronchi and you ultimately follow it to periphery, but there'll be a part of the lung in which normally I'm telling you won't be able to see bronchiole. Okay, normally you won't be able to see bronchiole at the periphery of the lung, and this is just, you know, 1 to 2 centimeter from the pleura. 1 to 2 centimeter from pleura. Bronchioles are basically not visible. Remember this thing. Okay, so if you are seeing bronchioles in the periphery of the lung, at this part of the lung, okay, this means that you have bronchiectasis because it is dilated. That's why it is showing itself. Okay, so bronchiole is visible only in the central part, but in the, you know, peripheral 1 to 2 centimeter, you know, you do not see it. Similarly, interlobular septa, I have just told, it doesn't show itself. Okay, pleura is also not visible. If you see, pleura is not also visible. We never see pleura unless it is thickened. Okay, lymphatics we don't see. Obviously alveoli and a sinus, these are not visible. No, you just simply see air, you will not see okay. And more importantly, what we see is basically the branch of pulmonary artery. So what we see simply is that we will see a central dot of pulmonary artery, that is what is visible. Okay, so we see central dots scattered like this in HRCT, and that is on cross section, that is what we see. Okay, and bronchioles we see in the away from periphery or towards center we see. Okay, so these are the things that we see commonly. Okay, and so just let's move to what we were discussing. So interlobular septal thickening. Okay, now interlobular septal thickening, why we call it to be thickened? We call it to be thickened when we starts to see it, because normally it is not visible. Okay, so we will see it only when it is thickened. Okay, and normal thickness is 0.1 mm. I just told it is normal thickness. When it will increase to 1 to 2 centimeter, 1 to 2 centimeter. Okay, we'll start to see it, which we call as thickened septa. Thickened septa. Okay, we'll start to see it, interlobular septal thickening. Okay. And remember this thing. When we call interlobular septal thickening, the thickening can be due to three things. Okay, what all can cause? So we go by the causes and we classify it. What all can cause the interlobular septal thickening? Okay, so it could be fluid that can cause it. Okay, and remember this thing. What was there in interlobular septa? What was there in interlobular septa? It is important to remember pulmonary vein. Okay, we have pulmonary vein there, and we have lymphatics there. These were the structures that were there. So in interlobular septa, it could be due to fluid. Other thing that it could be due to cells. And third and most important thing that can give rise to it is fibrosis. Okay, collagen, cells, and fluid. Example of fluid, obviously, if you have edema, okay, that can give rise to interlobular septal thickening. If you have cells, example, you have abnormal proliferation of cells, which are immunogenic cells, or it could be malignant cells. So you have malignancy, example, malignancy, or fibrosis is nothing but simply all those fibrotic disease. Example, let's say idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, IPF or UIP. This is an example. So all these things can lead to increased septal thickening. Okay, simple. Now, when it is thickened, how will it appear? So it is, these were the causes. Okay, how will it appear? So as you know, and I told you also, that in the periphery of the lung, this is your periphery of the lung. Okay, the secondary pulmonary lobule was like this, and in the central part of the lung it was like this, polygonal or hexagonal shape or whatever it is. It was like this. So when it gets thickened, it will form a polygon in the center, and in the periphery it will be like this. Okay, so these are going to be they will be perpendicular septa, at the periphery. Okay. And when they will get thickened, ultimately they will separate a lobule. You will start to see what secondary pulmonary lobule in the lung when the septa are thickened, because that is the outlining structure. And what you're going to see at the center of the lobule, which we normally see also, is the artery. That's going to be the appearance, okay, or the illustrative appearance of interlobular septal thickening. Okay, but another important point would be that this interlobular septal thickening, okay, we have interlobular septal thickening, how it's going to be appearing? Okay, how it's going to be appearing? So it's going to appear, appearance also tells us something. This interlobular septal thickening could be smooth, it could be nodular, it could be irregular. Now these are terminologies that you will use in report. Okay, you see interlobular septal thickening, we'll call it smooth, nodular, or irregular. Now, smooth is simply due to fluid. Remember this thing. Fluid will cause smooth. So, if you have edema, it will cause smooth. If you want to know about irregular, commonly fibrosis. Fibrosis causes irregular. Okay. And this one cause that is your lymphangitic spread of tumor or lymphangitic carcinoma. Carcinomatosis. That can cause either nodular or smooth, both. Remember this thing, it can cause both. Now, important thing to understand is irregular. Okay. It is irregular. So it causes irregular thickening. This means that something like this would be the appearance. So it basically will be, you know, causing like this. Like this. This irregular thickening. Now, since it is causing irregular thickening, what will happen? If fibrosis is there, why? Because fibrosis always is associated with attraction. It's like a spring. You know, it tries to pull structure surrounding it. So that is why it becomes irregular. And when there is irregularity, what will happen? Now, this doesn't look like a normal secondary pulmonary lobule. Since it doesn't look like a normal secondary pulmonary lobule, that is why architecture of the lung is lost. So architectural distortion is what we see when we have irregular interlobular septal thickening, and that is caused by fibrosis. So there are three causes and three appearances on HRCT. Whatever I'm going to discuss it on HRCT, and now we'll show how exactly, you know, it looks. So how exactly it's going to look. So just look at this. See this image. In this image, you can clearly see, okay, clearly see reticulopacies. So we are discussing reticulopacies. Under that, we discuss about, you know, interlobular septal thickening. Okay, remember this order that we are going to go. So if you see this part of the lung, this is center of the lung. This is not periphery. It is center of the lung. Okay. And let's see the normal part first. This is your normal part, let's say. So what you are seeing here, these are nothing but your branches of pulmonary arteries. Okay. These are branching of pulmonary artery. This. Okay. What is this? You do not see interlobular septa. Okay, but here you are seeing, and you are seeing polygonal areas. What are these? So these are nothing but your secondary pulmonary lobule, and you are able to see them. Why? Because we have what? We have interlobular septal thickening here. We have interlobular septal thickening. That is why we are able to see it. Okay. And here also at the periphery, look at the periphery of this lung. At the periphery, it is like this. Pleural surface. Okay. We can see pleural surface. It's parallel, it's perpendicular to pleural surface. Okay. In the center of the lung, it is forming what? Secondary pulmonary lobule. Okay. So this is what is interlobular septal thickening. Okay. At the center, there is, you know, if you see closely, there is a dot, central dot, that is a pulmonary artery. So this, whenever you see a secondary pulmonary lobule or SPL architecture, you should suspect that it is your, basically interlobular septal thickening. Now, another important point that is important to note is that this is also, you know, although there is one more finding here, you see, so you can see these reticulations, this networking, you can see this networking, okay. And this networking is nothing but, and you see these hexagonal structures or polygonal structures in the center part of the lung. At the periphery, you can see that's how on the periphery the secondary pulmonary lobule is. So these are nothing but your, again, interlobular septal thickening. This is interlobular septal thickening only. Here also. Interlobular septal thickening. But another important point that is there is that if you see the opacity or the density of the lung at this point and at this point, okay, obviously it is thickened, but there's also one more thing. There's a ground glassing also there, this particular part. There's a superimposed ground glassing was also there. Superimposed ground glassing. And since we have superimposed ground glassing, that is why these two important things, when they get combined, we call it to be crazy paving pattern. And that is what is shown here. Crazy paving pattern. Okay, anyway. Okay then. So the next thing that we're going to do, we're going to go for is, so we discuss about interlobar septal thickening, we discuss how does it appear. Now the next thing is, okay, and this comes under reticular opacities. Okay, so one more thing is going to happen, you know. Now let's say we were talking about fibrosis. Okay, we're talking about fibrosis. Now we discuss about secondary pulmonary lobule. This is your secondary pulmonary lobule, okay, and you know this is what was your interlobular septa, okay, and we discussed, you know, this was your pulmonary artery, and we also have a bronchial here, okay, so we have bronchial and we have pulmonary artery in the center, okay, and we have lymphatics and pulmonary vein here, okay. We know this thing. Now, important thing is that fibrosis can happen anywhere. Okay. Fibrosis commonly occurs site of fibrosis. That's what I'm going to discuss. You know, fibrosis can happen at fibrosis or fluid accumulation for that matter, or cells or whatever. These are the only three things we discuss. Whatever is going to happen, they're going to occur either in interlobular septa, at the boundary of secondary pulmonary lobule, or they can also happen in intralobular region. So this is your intralobular region, what is left, okay, because walls of alveoli is also part of interstitium. Here what is there, you know, you have alveoli here, alveolar ducts are here, okay, or basically the respiratory part is there. So you can have, you know, you have interstitium here also. Everything that is other than air is interstitium of the lung, okay, interstitium of the lung, okay, and other than vessels and other than your air is interstitium of the lung. So alveolar wall is also there, alveolar ducts wall is also there, respiratory bronchial wall is also there here. So these are also what interstitium areas, and you can also have fibrosis or fluid accumulation there also, okay. There also, so this is the intralobular part. This is what your intralobular part. So you can have all these things accumulating in interlobular septa as well and interlobular region as well. So when you see intralobular region also getting affecting, okay, so when intralobular region also getting affected, that also comes under, that will also cause reticulation. Okay, that is also called reticulation. Reticulation, to be precise, by literal meaning of reticulation means networking. It means networking. And why we have chosen word reticulation to represent what it appears is because it appears like a network. You saw interlobular septal thickening. What was it? You know, similar to, it was similar to a network. Okay, it was similar to a network. So that is why when we have interlobular septal thickening or intralobular septal thickening, we also have, you know, reticulations. And we have reticulations, when you have reticulations, so these opacities which are due to intralobular region fibrosis or fluid or cells in intralobular region are basically characterized under a specific term, that is your non-specific reticular pattern. Why? Because there is no specific pattern for it. It can happen anywhere around this center of the lobule, but it will be inside the lobule. So I am telling at the, you know, at that anatomical or, you know, structural basis where the fibrosis or fluid accumulation is going to be. Okay. So, you know, whether it is fibrosis, fluids or cell. Okay. If they are happening in your intralobular region, we call it under non-specific reticular pattern. Remember this thing. This is the category in which, you know, we go. So what we discuss about the reticular opacities. In first, we discussed about intralobular septal thickening, okay, which is this. And second thing that we are discussing is non-specific reticular pattern. Okay, and that happens similarly, primarily due to intralobular area. Okay, intralobular area. So that is what it is. Now, when you know, when you have intralobular reticulation or intralobular thickenings, okay, due to whether fibrosis there, cells is there, or fluid is there, basically in this part, okay, how does it appear on HRCT, and what exactly we call it? Okay, what exactly we call it when we have intralobular septal thickening? Intralobular septal thickening, not septal thickening, intralobular thickenings. It will have, you know, whatever the cause, fibrosis, cells, or row, we call it to be fine reticulation. We describe it in the form of fine reticulation. This is a term that you're going to use on report. You're going to report, or you can also use non-specific reticular areas. That also mean the same. But fine reticulation is what we see, or what we simply write on the report. So if you are writing fine reticulation, I mean to simply say that it is intralobular septum, intralobular thickenings. Intralobular thickenings are what is your fine reticulations. Okay, intralobular septal thickening are written like intralobular septal thickening only in the report. But when you write fine reticulation, we call it to be intralobular thickenings. Okay, and there is nothing but your intralobular interstitium that is getting affected. Okay, now another important point that is associated with it, and we'll move, you know, in a chain. We'll understand one thing, we'll move in another in a chain. This was your secondary pulmonary lobule, and you know, we have artery and a bronchial here, we have intralobular septa here, and we discuss the septa can get thickened, and you know, the interstitium inside the intra or inside the lobule can also get thickened. We call it fine reticulation. Okay, so we discuss about that, and intralobular septal thickenings, they come under, we just understood, they come under non-specific reticular pattern. Okay, non-specific reticular pattern, and that is why if you have fibrosis here, let's say the non-specific reticular pattern or fine reticulation was due to fibrosis. Let's say you have fibrosis here, and I just told you what fibrosis does. If let's say this is your fibrotic opacity in intralobular region, it will cause what? It will cause pulling of the structure surrounding it. So if it will cause pulling of the structure surrounding it, what is surrounding it in the center? In the center, you have either pulmonary artery branch, or you have bronchiole. These are the two structures in the center. Okay, and it will also cause pulling of the septa. Okay, so the surrounding structure also get thickened. So when you have fibrosis, it will cause what? Obviously it will cause architectural distortion, because you know that lobule will lose its appearance due to, you know, pulling of intralobular septa. And there is also a possibility that intralobular septal thickening is also coexistent, so it will also cause architectural distortion. But what I want to tell is that it will cause pulling of the wall of the bronchiole as well, and the bronchiole will ultimately what? Get dilated. It will get dilated. Now the important point to be considered here is that, do you think that bronchiole gets dilated on itself or due to some reason? So it gets dilated due to, or secondary to what? It gets secondary to fibrosis, it dilated. And that is why when a bronchiole or a bronchi, you know, that when it gets dilated secondary to fibrosis, so we use a prefix you know, in front of bronchiole or bronchi, and that prefix is nothing but your traction. And since it's get dilated, so for the dilating, dilation, we use the word ectatic, ectasis. Whether it's a bronchiole or bronchi, so if it's a bronchi, we call it to be bronchiectasis. And if it's a bronchiole, then we call it bronchial ectasis. Okay. So traction bronchiectasis or traction bronchial ectasis are nothing but simply dilation secondary to fibrosis. That's why word use traction is also there, because traction is there to cause a dilation. Now, since it is secondary to fibrosis, it's not primary. Primary bronchiectasis would be like, so for example, in the ABPA or allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis, you see, you know, in that particular thing, there's a simple chain of, bronchiectasis, you know, infection and obstruction. If you remember, and if you will have a video on this bronchiectasis also, infection plus obstruction. These are the two things that you require, and they have a vicious cycle. One, you know, leads to another. When you have this cycle going on in a bronchi, then it will be primary bronchiectasis. It is not due to fibrosis. Ultimately, fibrosis might develop due to these phenomena. Okay, but primarily this cycle, vicious cycle, is going on, and that causes dilation. Now, this particular type of bronchiectasis or bronchiolectasis is primary bronchiectasis, and it's not, you know, the primary pathology. There is some pathology, whether infection is there or obstruction is there, that causes bronchiectasis. But here it is due to fibrosis. So whenever it is due to fibrosis, we call it to be traction bronchiectasis. And whenever you see bronchiectasis, so when you have intralobular septal thickenings, or sometimes also interlobular septal thickenings, the associated finding is traction bronchiectasis. It suggests that fibrosis is there. Okay, so coexistent things are there. Okay, so traction bronchiectasis, that is what we saw. And that is why when we see traction bronchiectasis, okay, we start to see bronchioles at the periphery of the lung as well. So if we are seeing it on the periphery of the lung, this means that they are getting dilated. Normally we do not see in the 1 to 2 centimeter peripheral part of the lung. That is what is important. Okay, so the third thing that we discuss in the reticular pattern or reticular opacities is your traction bronchiectasis. Okay, traction bronchiectasis, and how does it appear? That is also important. Okay, so we're going to discuss that. Now, another important point is that we discuss three terms. Okay, interlobular septal thickening, we discuss non-specific reticular patterns, we discuss, and then we discuss traction bronchiectasis. Another important term that we are going to discuss is a very, very, very important term, and I'll show all of these, you know, on the image as well. So just wait for this one more concept that is very, very important. Okay, honeycombing. That is your honeycombing. Now it is important to understand honeycombing, and when we call something to be honeycombing, see. Whenever you have fibrosis, fibrosis is nothing but a chronic inflammatory response. It's basically organizing response. Whenever some damage to a structure or parenchyma is there, whenever some parenchyma gets damaged or acute inflammation, it is followed by chronic inflammation. Ultimately, fibrosis or collagen deposition is there. So what fibrosis does, I just told that it will cause what? Pulling. It will cause pulling of surrounding structure. Okay, it will cause pulling, and when pulling would be there, what will happen? Spaces will get dilated, air spaces will get dilated also. Due to fibrosis. So this means that fibrosis can give rise to cyst, and these appear like cyst. Or what I should say, air spaces will be dilated, or I could also say that alveolar destruction is there. Alveolar destruction is there because architecture of the lung is also getting distorted. You know, you have alveoli that are pulled up, and ultimately their walls get destroyed. Okay, so the spaces that were like this, you know, their walls start to disappear. And ultimately, these spaces are going to combine into forming large spaces. So these spaces, or this is what the pathogenesis of emphysema is also there, you know, that's alveolar destruction is going on. Ultimately, you know, small spaces, they combine to form, they coalesce to form large spaces. And that's, so whenever you have fibrosis, ultimately, late stage of fibrosis, you start to form cyst. Okay. Remember this thing, any fibrotic lung disease, which you'll, you know, see later, or, you know, in the videos that we have discussed so far, fibrotic lung disease, ultimately we have cyst there, scattered cysts are there. But there's a very advanced stage of this cyst formation also. And that advanced stage is honeycombing. So honeycombing is nothing but, remember this thing, first of all, it is advanced, it is seen in advanced fibrotic diseases. The presence of honeycombing means that fibrosis is at a very late stage. Okay, it's a very at a very late stage. This is what the meaning of honeycombing is there. Okay, now what is honeycombing? Next question becomes, what is honeycombing? So see, honeycombing is nothing but when you see, you know, this is your honeycombing, you know, in a normal practical way that we see. This is your honeycomb. Okay, this is typical honeycomb. Okay, that you're going to see. Now, similar to this, if you see this image, this image also appears like this. Okay, in the left part of the lung, or left lung parenchyma. Okay, so that is your honeycombing. That's why the name honeycombing is there. But we're going to, you know, understand, and we need to understand first that when do you call honeycombing? So there's a specific criteria of honeycombing. We have a criteria of honeycombing. And what is that criteria of honeycombing? So the criteria point number one is, you should have cyst. Should have cyst. Okay. Cyst would be obviously air filled. Second important point is that the wall of the cyst is thick. Thick wall of cyst. Thick walled cyst. Okay. Cysts are of variable size. Okay, they are variable size. They may be 3 mm to 1 cm. Anyway, they are cysts, they are thick walled cysts. Another important point, sharing of wall. There are multiple cysts and there is sharing of the walls of the cyst. Okay, the multiple cysts, they should share the wall, and the wall should be thickened also. And fourth important point is that the location of these cysts doing so should be subpleural. If you have these four criteria, only then you call it to be honeycombing. So you have these cysts, okay? Let's say these are the cysts. These are the cysts. Their wall are thick. And they're sharing the wall. Okay? They're sharing the wall. Then it calls to be honeycombing. Once you have this, and what is the minimum criteria for honeycombing is that you should have minimum criteria, something called minimum criteria. What is the minimum criteria? The minimum criteria is nothing but it is your three cysts in a row, like this. Three cysts in a row is a minimum criteria at obviously in subpleural location. Okay, this should be there, but they should be sharing walls. They are sharing walls. Okay, they are thick walled also. The wall should be thick. And if you have minimum three cysts in a row, you call it to be honeycombing. Okay, remember this thing. And there are, you know, primarily there are, you know, any fibrotic disease in its advanced stage can lead to honeycombing, but classical cause of honeycombing that is always there, and once you see honeycombing, you always need to rule out that particular disorder, and that is your what? That is your idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, or UIP. Okay, you cannot diagnose UIP without honeycombing. It's very difficult to diagnose. You will need a biopsy if you want to diagnose UIP without, you know, honeycombing. It's so linked to this particular disorder. Okay. Okay. So that is one thing. So just see, look at the, you know, honeycombing picture. So you can see there are multiple cysts. You can see the wall of the cyst also. Now that is well also important. You can see multiple cysts, they are aligned in a row, okay, air containing cyst, thick wall, okay, and they are sharing walls also. You can see they're sharing walls. So they are sharing walls. Okay. So since they are sharing wall also, here also, at this portion also, you can see they are sharing walls. The walls is thickened, and you know, at the subpleural location also, you also see it in the center also. Okay, this is honeycomb. All of this is honeycomb. Anyway, and that's what, if you see clearly, it's in the mid to lower part of lung. It could be UIP. Okay. Okay. What else we saw? So this is nothing but honeycombing is there. What else we saw? We saw crazy paving, we saw interlobar septal thickening. Okay, we saw this lobule. One thing that that was left is your this. Exactly this. So you can see this. See now what you can see is it's in the parallel location although, but you can see this bronchioles. See this bronchioles. Here, okay. See bronchioles there. Now, when you see this, see, are you seeing this bronchioles to be of normal, you know, morphology? No, they are not. They are literally corkscrew type. Corkscrew type, and they're irregular. And you see, you know, this high density structure or high attenuating structure. These are nothing but fibrotic areas. So fibrotic areas, and you know, they're surrounding it, and ultimately you see these bronchioles to be, you know, they are getting pulled up, and ultimately that they get dilated. So you don't see bronchioles at this point, up till this point, you do not see them. Okay, and if you compare these two lung fields, you see also see there is that there is, you know, little volume loss here. Volume loss also is there in comparison to this particular lung. Okay. And you see these corkscrew type structure, this is nothing but your traction bronchiectasis. Your traction bronchiectasis. And it is secondary to fibrosis. Okay, so we have traction bronchiectasis. We have fibrotic areas. Okay. Okay. So that's what we discussed. Non-specific reticular pattern is your interlobular septal thickening. Anyway, so let's move on to next stage. Okay, so I'm not telling much about, you know, I'm not telling much about this the DDs or where all you see honeycombing. It's you know, it's useless to waste time on that because we are going to discuss each and every disease in this particular chest series. Okay. So I told about honeycombing, you know, so you always see honeycombing in UIP, okay, mostly, okay, and if it is not honeycombing, then the diagnosis becomes either possible UIP or inconsistent with UIP, but you see, in a classical case of UIP, you will always see honeycombing, but, you know, similarly, you have interlobar septal thickening. Where do you have interlobar septal thickening, okay, so I discuss about the causes about, you know, it could be fluid, it could be fibrosis, it could be cells, you know, so, that is all about the reticular opacity. So reticular opacity is like this only, okay, it can cause reticulations, and this interstitial fibrosis only, okay, interstitial fibrosis or causing honeycombing, or you know, this traction bronchiectasis, these also appear on the x-ray, chest x-ray, and they're also there cause reticular areas. They're also the reticular opacity word is used. Okay, we'll discuss it, okay, or let's discuss it now only. So chest x-ray also, okay, so we discussed about this, few things we discussed. One thing that we discussed was interlobular septal thickening. Okay, second thing we discussed was non-specific reticular pattern. Okay, third thing we discussed was honeycombing. The fourth thing we discussed was your traction bronchiectasis. I would say traction bronchiectasis. It will appear just like, basically secondary to fibrosis. So let's not just, but if you see these three patterns on X-ray, because bronchitis would appear like a dilated bronchial only, or there might be, if there is inflammation in the wall of the bronchi, it will appear like a peribronchial thickening on X-ray. But all these three things will produce what? Reticular pattern on chest X-ray. Okay, they will appear like a reticular pattern on chest X-ray. Okay, so these are the HRCT findings. Remember, these are HRCT findings. Okay, non-specific reticular pattern is nothing but your, you might call it to be fine reticulation. Okay, fine reticulation. But on HRCT, these terminologies used. Honeycombing will never use on chest X-ray. Okay, what honeycombing causes on chest X-ray is a reticular pattern of a particular type, but you will not call it to be honeycombing on chest X-ray. Honeycombing is a HRCT pattern. Similarly, fine reticulation or interlobal septal thickening or traction bronchiectasis as well. These are the things that you call it on HRCT. You do not call it on X-ray. On X-ray, you call it to be reticular pattern. So what all on X-ray, if you see reticular opacities, I'm discussing what X-ray. If you see reticular opacities, on X-ray, we divide into three categories. Okay, that is your fine reticular opacities, medium reticular opacities, and coarse. Fine, medium, and coarse. Remember this thing. Fine, medium, and coarse. And what is the basis? So on X-ray, what you will see, reticulation is what? Networking. So you will see reticular opacities like this. Okay, you see like this. And when you see reticular opacities like this, what will happen? These reticulations, because there is a networking, so they will include what? Among these reticulations, there will be empty spaces or air containing spaces that will be bordered by these reticular opacities. Okay, so if you have more reticulation, or if you have more reticulation, you will see that the spaces that is bordered by, or the the clear spaces that are bordered by these reticulations will become small. If the reticulation increases, the spaces bordered by, size of spaces decreases, and this is the size of space actually that is a basis of dividing this reticular opacities into fine, medium, and coarse. If the spaces are large, this means that reticulation, spaces could be large also, spaces could be small also. So we have a specific size criteria for that. Okay, if you have size criteria of 3 mm, less than 3 mm, if these spaces are less than 3 mm, you call it to be fine. Okay, if you have 3 mm to 2 mm, 10 mm, sorry, you call it to be medium. And if you have more than 10 mm, you call it to be coarse. Okay, these reticular opacities. So you have fine, medium, and coarse reticular opacities on chest X-ray. And the basis is simply the spaces that is being bordered by these reticular opacities on chest X-ray. Okay, and important point to be understanding, we understand it here, is that when we call medium, commonly we have fine to medium. Okay, when we call medium reticular opacity on chest X-ray, okay, this means obviously the spaces that are bordered are 3 mm to 10 mm. Okay, then this is associated on HRCT with honeycombing. Okay, so the cyst of honeycombing, they create this type of pattern on chest X-ray. So this is a chest X-ray finding. Corresponding finding on HRCT of this particular thing is your honeycombing. Okay. Okay, now whatever it is, okay, let's say example you have fine reticulation pattern. Now fine reticular pattern or fine reticulations on HRCT means intralobular septal thickening, okay, intralobular thickenings. Similarly, another important point would be, so you have fine, medium or coarse, whatever it is, okay. Now important point to be considered here is, see, can you, okay, fibrosis or interlobular septal thickening or intralobular septal thickening, or you have honeycombing, all these can give rise to reticular pattern, okay. All this can give rise to honeycombing, reticular pattern in chest x-ray, okay. Can cyst for that matter, cyst, if you have multiple cyst in the lung, multiple cyst, can they give rise to reticular pattern? Obviously yes. The reason is very clear, okay. Reason is very clear. What is that? See, this is your, let's say this is your cross section of the CT, this is your CT cross section, okay. So you see things in two dimension, definitely at a CT cross section you see things in two dimension. Third dimension is obviously when you scroll it, so you add the third dimension, but at a particular section you have a two dimension, AP and TR, okay. Third dimension you add, that is craniocaudal, when you scroll it, so you have two dimension, but an X-ray is also a two dimensional structure and nothing but, you know, so whatever, let's say something is here and something is here and rays are going to pass like this and you have an X-ray film, so whatever this and this, they are going to overlap and create an image, they are going to create a common image on X-ray. So this overlapping concept is also there on X-ray, that structures overlap. So if you have two cysts, let's say you have a cyst here and your cyst here, cysts are located like this and you have an X-ray over it, so this cyst and this cyst are going to overlap and ultimately the image that will form, like that will, this will form, by a logic you can clearly see, it will create a network, okay, it will create a network like this, it will appear like this, and there will be so many cysts, you know, at this, let's say there are so many cysts. So when they get overlapped, you will create what? This will also create a reticular pattern because it appears like a network. So if you have cyst in the lung or multiple cyst in the lung, that can also give rise to reticular pattern. That is why cystic diseases of the lung, they commonly appear with a reticular pattern on chest X-ray. Okay, on chest X-ray they appear like a reticular pattern. So reticular pattern can also, you know, created by cystic lung diseases, okay. So cystic lung disease, okay. Now cyst could be, you know, could be like, say, for example, bronchiectatic cyst, or it could be cystic lung disease like lymphangeal leiomyomatosis, okay, Langerhans cell histiocytosis, okay. There are cystic diseases also, but whatever cysts are there, multiple cysts. Now if the size of the cyst is going to vary, let's say you have small cyst or you have large cyst, on that basis you can have medium reticular opacity, fine reticular opacity or coarse reticular opacity, whatever it is, on the basis of the cyst size, okay. Okay, so that was about the reticular patterns on chest X-ray, okay, and I can see it also on image. See this X-ray. So let's see, now you can see clearly that you have a bilateral reticular pattern, and if you see closely, we go, you know, here you can see small spaces that are there. So you can see this is small spaces, at this where my pointer is, this small spaces or this small spaces, these small spaces, these small spaces. Now these are, you know, they appear like around I would say it is around less than 3 mm or 3 to 10 mm. Some are 3 to 10 mm, some are less than 3 mm. So it's fine to medium reticular pattern that is there. Okay, fine to medium reticular pattern is there. This chest X-ray. Okay. Then if you see this. Okay. You see this? See at the bases. At bases you can see reticular pattern. Basis or mid part of the, you know, you can see reticular pattern. And characteristically, if you describe this X-ray, bases, you know, and you also see spaces here. If you clearly see on my pointer, you have spaces. Okay, so there are also, you know, you also, there are more than 3 mm, so 3 to 10 mm. Okay, so it's a medium reticular pattern. And since it's a medium reticular pattern, so it goes with the finding of honeycombing on HRCT. Honeycombing on HRCT. On HRCT only. You call honeycombing on HRCT. Now, important thing is that you have bilateral basal pattern of medium reticular opacity. So, on chest X-ray, you should suspect a diagnosis of UIP here. Okay, well, they will not write UIP in the report. Obviously, on chest X-ray, you have to go for HRCT to confirm it. But the pattern, the distribution, okay, it goes in favor of UIP. Okay. Then, okay. So, here also you can see, you know, you have a reticular pattern here also. Especially, you know, this thickening of interlobar septa is also not minor fissures also there here. Okay, but we have, you know, reticular pattern if you see closely. And if you see here, see this. This is a zoomed image, okay, inset. So you have, you know, these. There are small reticulations here also. And they're also polygonal if you see. Okay, so you have reticular pattern here also, and the spaces are very coarse. Okay, not coarse, I would say this is not a coarse reticular pattern, definitely. But you'll see that there are fine reticulations, small reticulations. Okay, because it is not more than 10 mm, definitely. But there are fine reticulations. Okay, so it could be fine reticular pattern, okay, less than 3 mm, or it could be, it can also be listed as, you know, it might be intralobular thickening, it may be associated with intralobular thickening also, which is called a fine reticular pattern. Okay, when we have coarse reticular pattern, it's although not that common, but you can have it on if you have large cyst also there. If you have multiple cysts and that are large cysts, so the overlapping will create large spaces. Okay, large spaces between the, you know, these networking. Okay, and that is what will create a coarse pattern. Okay. So these were the chest X-ray finding of the reticular patterns. Okay, now we discuss the next important thing as a part of the basics of HRCT, and that is your nodular pattern. Okay, that's also going to be the most, you know, one of the most important finding